up, Brandon Eamon, in the audience. We are pleased to be joined now by the mayor of the city of Baltimore, Baltimore City Mayor Brandon Scott. Good morning, Mr. Mayor.
Hey, Mr. Mayor.
Good morning. Good morning, C4. Good morning, Brian. How are you today? Good.
Doing great. You have started, you tweeted out on Tuesday that nearly 3,000 people joined you and Acting Commissioner Richard Worley during one of your community engagement meetings. Then you had another one yesterday. Tell me, and you plan on having seven of these all together. Tell me about the first two that you've had, and what are you hoping to accomplish, Mr. Mayor, you and Commissioner Worley?
Yeah, thank you, C4. We're holding these meetings, virtual meetings, to provide an opportunity for the Acting Commissioner to connect directly with residents in Baltimore leading up to his confirmation hearing. We know why we went with Commissioner Worley. We know that many of the residents in the city already know him, but we want to make sure that every single section of the city, every single type of community gets to interact with him. That first one was a telephone town hall with older adults. And then last night, of course, we were on live on my social media pages that allows folks to ask him questions directly. Because we know during his tenure as deputy commissioner, he's been right at the center of senior leadership positions, right at the center of reducing the violence in Baltimore, but also going throughout consent decree reforms, building the community violence intervention ecosystem. We want everyone to hear what he wants to do and how he wants to operate the police department. And we're holding these meetings, seven total, as you said, two telephone town halls, one that was specifically for older adults, and we'll have another one of those, the virtual meeting, and then four in-person sessions, starting with the first one that is coming up next week.
So is that going to guide you in any direction, what people are saying, and what have you heard so far?
Well, the truth is what we've heard is that so far is that what we already know and the stuff that you and I talk about, right? Mm-hmm. And C4 we talk about. We hear from people about how we want folks want them to continue to go after guns. People end up asking, which is great about these things, what else can be done? And they ask the same questions that the three of us talk about every month, right? Well, why, if the police department is arresting more people with guns and they continue to arrest the same people, which allow the commissioner to go a little bit more in depth about the partnerships that we're trying to build with the state and other folks to resolve other problems within the criminal justice system, allowing him to explain things that he's planning to do about recruitment and retaining of police officers, talking about the consent decree reforms and what they really mean and not what folks think they mean. And I think we've heard questions from all over the spectrum, Brian, about simple things on people's blocks. We had questions last night around internal affairs. We had questions around what he believes is a role for community policing, questions around where the guns are coming from, all of those type of things, and that's what we want these to be, because that allows the commissioner to answer those questions directly. And then in some cases, when it's a policy question or something that is not just around Baltimore, but around dealing with this issue across state, across the country, then it's where it's more appropriate for me to answer.
Brandon Scott, the mayor of the city of Baltimore, is on board with us. And Mayor Scott, you know, we can look at the last fall, really September, October, as the real beginning of the reduction of homicides and non-fatal shootings. You're now well over 20% reduced so far as homicides this year, 2023, over 10%. I'm sure you hear the exact numbers, well over 10% non-fatal shootings. We've talked with U.S. Attorney Eric Barron the last couple of days, as well as State Attorney Ivan Bates. Would it be fair to say, of course, you know, GVRS and what you've done with that, but that having the prosecutors, you know, be a little more supportive, I put it that way, that all of that together has helped to see some of this reduction?
You hear me say it all the time, and you heard you at this time last year and even the years before, the three of us were talking about it has to be everything. Not one thing, not one agency is ever going to be responsible for the reduction or an increase when you're talking about violence, right? And so, yes, having those deeper partnerships with those officers work, because as you know, and Brian knows, BPD was making arrests before. They were already making those arrests. But now having those deeper partnerships with the U.S. attorney, with the state's attorney, allows that work to not sometimes be in vain. But It's also about how everyone is bought in on the same strategy. I think that's very important. Everyone from the state's attorney to the U.S. attorney is bought in on understanding the completeness and the holisticness of the public safety strategy that we have and focusing in every way, right? One of the first things that when U.S. attorney Barron was installed, we were able to give him the detectives from the gun trafficking unit that we had started, because now we knew that we had a partner there that believed in focusing in on folks with targeting folks who were using and bringing guns into our city. We know that the state's attorney has been bought in on all of the strategies, and we're in lockstep. And of course, the most important of that you mentioned is GVRS, where we all are focused on how we can approach the groups of folks who are most likely to be a victim or perpetrator of violence, offering first services. And if they don't, then we all come down, starting with me in the police department, bringing down the weight of law enforcement on those people.
Talking with the mayor of Baltimore, Brandon Scott, here in the C4 and Brian Emmett show. We are more than a month since the mass shooting in Brooklyn Homes. I know it's under investigation, but can you give us any update about where we are in that investigation?
Yeah, what I'll say, and the commissioner, we fielded this question last night too on the internet, is that they are every day pushing towards making sure that we hold these folks accountable. I am not going to, as you know, Brian, give out direct details about that, but what I want the residents of Baltimore and your whole listening area to know is that this is still the top priority for BPD, and that they, working with our other local partners and local police departments, state partners, and our federal partners, are going to continue until we bring the other folks responsible in.
And let's just say that Ivan Bates, when he was in here, the prosecutor obviously said that one of the things that he thinks is a problem here is the fact that there is a new law that says
can't interview people.
The Interrogation Act.
Mm-hmm. And he says it's got to be changed. We've talked with Scott Schellenberger, Baltimore
Rich Gibson,
County.
Howard County.
So this is definitely a problem that prosecutors see. Do you agree with them? And would you like Annapolis to look at that bill, if not, or just repeal it altogether?
I think what I'll say, Brian and C4, is that I've been telling folks long before that, right? And you know, I love my state's attorney, but is that we have to look at the entirety of that system when it comes to juvenile justice and see all things that need to be changed. And yes, we know that people can lure up and all of these things, but it makes it extremely difficult when you have 30 people shot, or when you can't talk to a lot of the folks that were there, right? We have to figure out a way to protect people's rights and protect especially young people's rights, but we also have to find a way to make sure that we can bring justice for families and do that in the right way.
But his point was that these public defenders are the ones that are coming in and say, hey, you can't talk to him, don't talk to him.
Even if a parent says it's okay, if the parent says, yes, you may talk to my child, the public defender can overrule the parent.
And the public defender may have a conflict of interest because that public defender may be representing somebody who is already accused of a crime that they may know something about, the person who they want to interrogate.
Yeah, no, he and I spoke about that as well. I think that, again, that's why we have to look at all of it, right? Because, you know, when it comes to a young person, the average person in Baltimore and all of Maryland is going to think that the parent has the last say, right? And I think that we have to understand that, and we need to build a system that allows for that accountability to happen, and understanding what public defenders do and the great job that they do as well. But we have to have the ability to have the accountability necessary. But it's not just about that either. As you know, I'm going to mention it because I'm going to do it every month. We have to deal with home monitoring and making sure that actually is done the right way, 24/7, 365, like the average citizen think it is. So, in allowing police departments like the city and others in the county police departments to act based on notification and things from the state, as we wanted to do with the law this year, there are so many things, and we're looking forward to working with the General Assembly and the governor as they come up to session to start to talk about those.
You know, Mayor Brandon Scott, we've talked before about the reluctance, I'll put it that way, of the judges to participate in a criminal justice coordinating council and the efforts that we talked with State Senator Corey McCray, we're trying to do to get them on board. But this latest case, we had State's Attorney Ivan Bates in here. I know you're reluctant to call out judges, but we had a judge to dismiss a murder case in the city of Baltimore when a state's attorney, assistant state's attorney, had the flu, had a doctor's note saying all he needed was 24-hour delay in the case, and the judge dismissed the murder case. Now, fortunately, this guy was already in prison on another charge and wasn't released. But the point is, for citizens hearing that, Mr. Mayor, that is not making us safe when we have judges acting like that.
No, and I mean, I'm going to say it again. We heard this conversation over both of the town halls, and I think it's important for folks, and I always appreciate you and Brian and other folks in the media who lift that up, right? Because we know that folks get pigeonholed into thinking that when an arrest is made and then that person is back out, then that's the responsibility of the police department. No, their job is to effectuate that arrest. We have to have them back at the table, and we're going to continue to push in every way because we need that accountability.
But they're not coming, Mr. Mayor, with all due respect. What about getting the governor on board? What about getting others on board to help to make them come to the table?
Well, I think that the governor's office, we know the governor's office is on board because all the state agencies are at the table, right? So we know that. And we're going to do, and the state's attorney, we know the U.S. attorney, everyone is figured out and try a way to do that. We're going to continue to push, and we'll do everything that we need to do to get them at the table. C4, you know I'm not going to stop until they do. But the number one thing that we need...
You know how you get them to the table? I'm sorry about you still now, but hold up the budget. You hold up some money, you get folks' attention. I'm sorry, but that's just like playing games.
We'll leave that to the governor and the governor general assembly to take that route. But I'll say that we're going to keep pushing, but what we need is for residents to start to hold and talk about that as well, and not just allow themselves to be put in a position where they're thinking it's just BPD or the state's attorney.
There was a move last month where the housing authority okayed private security in public housing communities, including Brooklyn Homes, to kind of patrol the area, and they are going to be armed as well. I am curious, how does that work, and is that an indication that, you know, we are so short on police officers that we have to go through these very unusual measures?
Well, Brian, I'll tell you that the housing authority had already had private security, so that's not a new thing. They've had it for a long time now. Actually, one of the gentlemen that helps to run their security is a former BPD person that I worked with for many years. And C4 will remember, Brian, that the housing authority used to have its own police force, and that went away sometime.
That was the biggest mistake we made, was letting that go away.
Early 2000s, I think. It was way before I even went to college, I believe. And what it is about now is making sure that we have that partnership with them. We're going to continue to have BPD support them, but they also have their own private security, and we're going to work with them very deeply.
Mr. Mayor, we have Artscape coming up, and there were some issues related to how Artscape was going to come off September 14th. I think many of those have been put to bed, but you also made the announcement about some really big acts coming. Can you talk about in September what Artscape is going to look like?
Listen, we're excited to have Artscape back, C4. It's a Baltimore tradition that I know you and Brian and everyone else are very fond of.
That was the first one.
Thankful to all of our partners for the opportunity to bring it back this year. We able to do it, but we're not just doing it the traditional way. We're going to have the traditional footprint in Mount Vernon. We're going to have that activated, but we're going to stretch it across North Avenue to engage our Station North community and that arts district. And we're going to have plenty of opportunities to showcase vendors, all the things that we love, and have everything for all ages. But we all know, C4, that everyone wants to know who's going to be on the big stage performing at Artscape, right?
Yep.
So we're excited. I was excited on Monday to announce that we have a singer-songwriter and one child of Destiny, Destiny's Child, Kelly Rowland, coming on Friday night. On Saturday night, we have Niles Rogers and Chick, and we have Dr. Mad Vibe featuring Fishbone and Angelo Moore. We'll be on our North Avenue stage, and we want everyone to come out and enjoy what's going to happen at Artscape. But C4, because I'm plugging events right now, also want folks to come out and make sure that they enjoy Charm City Live on August the 26th, which we've moved down to Pratt Street. It's going to be live on Pratt Street, as I'm sure, C4, you remember the days when we used to close Pratt Street to have festivals. We're going to do
Baltimore
that again.
City Fair. We used to have a city fair to close
fair
it.
Right on Pratt Street. We're going to have a singer-songwriter, Her. We're going to have Donald Jones. We're also going to have the immortal MC Light. We want everyone to come down to Pratt Street. We'll have vendors, and we'll have a great Charm City Live Festival as well.
All right. MC Light, like that. All right. I have to ask about the Orioles because, you know, I know you said Jay-Z
line.
Yes, we're
going to win the World Series.
I'm with you on that.
I'm with you, too.
This year, next year, 2 years down the road? What year?
This year. Book it.
All
we're
right.
winning it this year.
By the way, Mr. Mayor, I'm on the record last year saying the Orioles would have a winning record, and they finished 83-79, so I'm pretty good at projecting, too. So I'm
well,
with you.
Don't
I'm
forget
with you.
That I predicted they would do it and try to bet on it at the Horseshoe Casino in front of everybody, and they wouldn't let me do it. Remember that.
Yeah, I do.
So somebody down there owes me a bunch of money.
Dude, you could have made a lot of money on that. C4 actually has a T-shirt with the
I do. Record. They made it for me here.
But I did on the lease, and I know you Jay-Z, 99 problems, the Orioles aren't one, but do you know what the holdup is? Because it is firmly believed by me, judging from some of the reports out there, that the Orioles would like more than just an investment into the stadium, that they want to redevelop that entire area. Is that the holdup? Do you know, and are you at all concerned about it?
I'm not. Again, I am not concerned. And as you just said, I have 99 problems, but the Orioles are definitely not one of them. But what I'll say is that, listen, we're going to be there to support. We know that the governor and his team, as this is a Maryland Stadium Authority property, are going to be working and taking the lead on working with the Orioles. I know that John and Angelos and the team have been in communication with him, and we have a great chair of the Maryland Stadium Authority. The deal is going to, the contract is going to get signed. The lease is going to get signed. It's going to get done, everybody. What we should be focusing on is making sure that you're getting in line to get your playoff tickets now, not just for this year. Get your season tickets for next year, because we're going to be back in it for the foreseeable future, because the team is back.
Well, one of the things I have to remind sometimes, Mr. Brian Niemann, you and the mayor and others, the youngsters, is that before Nile Rodgers, but before Sugar Hill Gang had their song, Good Times was an actual song before it was background music for a rapper. So I just want you to
know.
You don't know. All you guys do is listen to that background and sample stuff. Don't know where the origin comes from.
Hey, by the way, you have a big movie coming out as well, a movie on you. Have you seen it yet? And are you happy with the way it came out?
Well, I have seen it. The Body Politic, which will is be at a film festival in Baltimore on August the 20th at Chall Theater at 1 p.m. If folks are interested, it's really about it. If you saw the documentary Charm City, which I was one of the subjects in, mm-hmm. it kind of picks up where that movie ended right as the campaign started, and then it goes through my first couple years in office talking about what we're talking about, mm-hmm. and that is all the time. Building this violence reduction work, building GVRS, so folks will get to see that in a very intimate way from the inside, and also see, what really it is like to be in my position. So I'm pleased with it. You know, I have seen it. I will tell you that, Brian, I won't be watching it again. So when folks say like there's a, and who wants to watch themselves in a movie over and over, man? I think that would just be a little self-serving and narcissistic to do that. But I will be participating in many of the panel discussions around it, myself and other folks who are featured in the movie. We did that in Washington, D.C. Last month. The team got to go to Europe, and then they were in Zanzibar where the documentary won Best Documentary at the film festival there in Zanzibar. So we're looking forward to bringing it home here to Baltimore.
You're big in Zanzibar.
Uh-huh.
Hey, well, did C4 or did I make an appearance there at all?
You know what? I got to think about whether I have to think about whether a clip of us talking on air was on there. It was a lot of media clips, so I have to think about
that. Well, Mr. Mayor, once again, get those World Series tickets printed up. I'm with you. I think that's where
we're going to do it. Ben.
That's
Let's
where
go.
We're headed. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you very much, gentlemen.
Good stuff.
I appreciate
Thank you, Mr.
it.
Mayor.